Everybody, and welcome to the show. I'm Todd McKim, along with the coach, and we'll take a look at the Oregon State victory. Also, take a look at the conference standings, try to figure out what might happen with regard to bowl consideration, have a couple of special features, and also maybe take a sneak peek at what might happen as far as next year is concerned as well. Well, coach, the weather conditions were certainly far from being ideal in Corvallis for Saturday's game. Wind, rain, it was a miserable day. And about the only thing that makes people feel good is the fact you win the game, you get out of the stadium, you get into the locker room with that W.
Well, I'm going to tell you something about going to Corvallis in recent years. We have not had what you would call good weather up there, I think, in the last four trips. This was probably the worst weather we've had, however. 30-mile-an-hour winds and constant rain. The rain got heavier and heavier and heavier. The interesting thing is, when the game was over, it stopped. Yeah. Now, that makes a lot of sense. I mean, we could have played today, mm-hmm. we could have played Friday and had wonderful weather, but no, we play Saturday in an absolute rainstorm. It looked like we were playing on a lake out there. The traction was good, but there was standing water. The ball soaked the water up. It was like trying to throw shot puts if you were trying to pass the ball.
You know, it's interesting that when you looked at the first half, the weather conditions looked like they might have actually favored you just the way that the first half transpired. Oregon State put the ball on the carpet seven times. You recovered one of their fumbles, and you didn't turn it over at all in the first half.
Well, we were conscious of trying to protect the football. You don't like to rationalize, but certainly a ground-oriented offense should have less problem with inclement weather than one who is a balanced offense who likes to throw the football. And we obviously couldn't throw the football as well as we're capable of throwing it under those weather conditions with the wetter ball plus the wind. Mm-hmm. The wind was a major factor in trying to throw anything deep particularly. So I think it limited what we could do offensively.
Defensively, it certainly didn't limit what your guys can do. That was as good a job against that offense as we've seen in a long, long time. Your outside linebackers, Edwards and Jones, constantly applying pressure off the corners. Joe Farwell had another great game in the middle. It just seemed that your coaching staff did a very good job of analyzing what you could do and got it done.
Well, I think Coach Sheffield and Coach Aliotti and Coach Terrell and Coach Schuler, obviously, in a very short preparation week, we went back and looked at the Hawaii film and saw some of the things that we did not do very well in that game. Got our people lined up right, and more importantly, I think our players were intense and ready to play football. Very emotional, and we really flew to the football. They were unable to sustain any type of inside running game on us, and that's what they really killed us with a year ago. Not the outside option, but just pounding us with the second back through, the counter play and stuff inside. They never could establish that. They very seldom were able to get outside. I think we had 16 tackles of negative yardage by our defense, and certainly the down linemen did an excellent job of keeping the Oregon State linemen off of our inside backers, allowing Massey, Farwell, and Asher to flow to the football and make some great hits. Ernest Jones and Terrell Edwards outside not only made great plays when it came to them, they ran down from the backside and made some plays. So I just don't think you can say enough about our defensive performance. When you hold a wishbone offense to 88 yards rushing, you've done an unbelievable job, 110 yards of total offense. It can't get much better than that.
No, it is difficult. The kicking game, obviously the conditions had a major effect on the kicking game. A kickoff sailing into the end zone when they were with the wind. Punting into the wind, if a guy could punt the ball 30 yards, he probably had a heck of a kick. And handling punts and so forth, I thought Ronnie Harris did a good job in that department. Tommy Thompson had about two or three punts where he had a little rough time handling the ball, and one was almost blocked. We saw that earlier this year.
Well, Tommy saved us from a major disaster in the kicking game on a couple of occasions. We didn't block very well. Oregon State had a man right up the middle in position to block the ball. Tommy had kind of had a hard time handling the snap. He came up, got his hands on the ball, saw the man coming, sidestepped him, stepped up past him, and punted the ball down the field for a real nice punt.
Well, as we mentioned before, the weather conditions certainly had an effect, and they, right off the get-go, Oregon State won the toss of the coin, and unusual for a team to defend to start the football game, but really that was a no-brainer because with the weather conditions as they were, you had to go right into this stiff wind in the first quarter.
We did. We came out with the reverse. Like to have seen Ronnie stay outside. Tattersall had position, but we pick up 8 yards on that. Come back with the toss into the boundary for Burwell, and we're able to get one first down. Throw a little swing pass to Burwell out there, only picks up about 3.
So, second down?
Almost.
And now this is the third down play.
Almost, just off of Anthony Jones's fingertips.
So this is what we were talking about, weather condition. Look at that ball just die.
Yeah, you got a kind of a side spin on it, and the wind just took it and pushed it dead right.
So Oregon State with their first possession. Great field position at their own 46.
Castle turns him inside. Farwell smothers him.
Look at Jones run down Olford from the backside.
Backside. I don't think Olford's too used to having many guys catching from the back. Excellent job by Chad Cota there. And Romeo Bandison, the big guy, getting a lot of help. As you can see, we're flying around. Very emotional game. Here comes the pitch from, looks like the camera lens is fogged up a little bit.
It is.
I can't imagine why. And you can see big Romeo there spinning the back to the ground.
So Oregon State forced to punt it away. And Oregon.
Ooh, yes. That's one of those. You break that tackle and he's gone. Great block there, great block there, and away he goes. Not quite fast enough. Oregon State had the angle on him, but a big play. Get a good block by Vince Ferry, the tight end. John Tattersall, 64, right there, chops the linebacker, and Shedrick annihilates the support man. Absolutely annihilates him. And what clear sailing Ricky Whittle had on this play.
Big gain. In fact, the longest play of the day, 47 yards.
Come right back with the same play, step out of bounds after a gain of about 5.
Fourth and 4, 37-yard field goal attempt. And I mean, in all honesty, Tommy can kick them from 57 and maybe even 65, but on a day like today, 37 was going to be a heck of a kick.
Well, and it was a crosswind, too, and it Ernest stays home on the naked boot here. You can see Olford trying to get him to bite to chase. I guess they figured since he caught him from the backside on the option, now they'd come back and fool him. Well, on this day, Ernest Jones was not to be fooled.
It's a play Oregon State has not used much this year.
And here he comes again, making the catch from the backside and forcing Olford into a bad pitch. Alex Molden on the pitch man.
So, third and 18.
The old quick kick. And good play, goes out of bounds. I think they get about a 51-yard kick on it.
So that's the last play we see. We are ready for the second quarter highlights. Oregon State has the football in with good field position at the Oregon 42-yard line.
Ernest Jones takes two blockers out of the way and allows Farwell to scrape to the quarterback. Textbook tackle. What a great play by Joe Farwell. Minus 4 yards on Olford.
So on a third and 10, Olford with the option, this time keeps and finds a crease, hurdles a tackler, and gets the first down.
Romeo Bandison comes all the way out from the inside of the line to make the play, and now Romeo's got a chance to make a big play coming up after this pass completion for a first down.
First and 10 at the 20.
And Romeo's going to try to grab this ball out. He gets it out, can't hang on. Come on, big guy, pick it up and run. And Mark Olford recovers. An almost near big play here. You can see it on the replay again. He does a good job coming from the backside. He's got his arms around him. Now he's going to get the ball, and he's got it out. He just can't hang on to it. Got to work on his hands, I can tell.
Well, those former soccer players never did have to use their hands.
Yeah, that's so. Right.
Second down and 14. And this was a key, Coach, that they just weren't able to run in the middle in this game.
Trap play, stopped by Joe Farwell, and again, coming up, Joe Farwell on the option again, stuffs it. Absolutely no chance here. You can see, again, Ernest Jones takes out two blockers. That frees up Farwell to come out and make the tackle. Unselfish defense in this football game.
Fourth and 19, Oregon State disdains really trying to kick the ball into that strong wind, went with the fake, and it went nowhere.
And big Romeo shows up again, busts through. gets there along with Gary Williams to make the tackle for a loss.
All right, we're going to go to the next series, and here's that one that Tommy bailed you out on. He gets it away somehow, some way. Not only that, gets a great roll, and Oregon State almost fumbles it here as Dwayne Owens makes a bad play on the ball.
It's just a great athletic play on Tommy Thompson's part. He's having trouble handling it. He sees a guy come in, he sidesteps him and just punts the ball away, just like there's nothing to it.
And because he ran with the ball, yes, that means there's no roughing.
Yeah, he loses his protection from being roughed in that situation. Good job by Terrell Edwards forcing the bad pitch. And big loss for Oregon State. You can see Terrell Edwards coming off, forcing the pitch. He hits Olford, and the pitch goes behind the Oregon State back. And he slides safely into third.
Next play, big play. Fumble comes loose. Joe Farwell recovers.
Big, big play. Farwell had a great game, as well as did a lot of people. But nice job here by Gary Williams, canceling the fullback. And Farwell recovering the fumble, giving us a great opportunity with field position. Play action pass. Throw the screen pass out the backside to Burwell. I thought he was going to score here. He gets down on about the 1.5 yard line. Unfortunately, on this play, you can't see it on the film here. We're called for a personal foul away from the play over to the left-hand side. So having a first and goal there, it's a dead ball foul. We get first and 17. Throw the slant plant pass to Kristen McLemore, who's come up with a couple of big catches in recent weeks, redshirt freshman. Nice play, good throw by Danny O'Neill. Protects the football well here, takes a couple of hits, and gets us to the 3 yard line.
So on third and goal from the three, O'Neill flips back to Willie Tate, who makes the reception, stays inbounds for the touchdown. It's the only touchdown of the ball game, and so it's no surprise that is our play of the day.
Well, we've lined up in the two tight end set here quite often, and we have a third tight end in the game here. What we did was kind of roll back away from it here, have Obi Babs come off and release inside. We've got Vince Ferry over here and Willie Tate here. And Willie comes down acting like we're all going to go this way. And then he breaks it back to the outside. And Danny sets up, sees him over there. Was actually fairly well covered, but Willie went up above the Oregon State defensive back. And Danny put the ball up where he could catch it. And he came down with it in the backside of the end zone for the touch.
As we look at it again,
you see, lofts the ball up high, and Willie goes up high over the Oregon State defender and comes down with it.
So Willie Tate becoming a big play receiver for Oregon. Thompson in to attempt the extra point, and this one's through. Well, let's get into the third quarter highlights to show you how strong the wind was. Remember that Tommy Thompson field goal that hardly went 40 yards? Well, watch the kickoff. Look at that. And Jamie Burke did the same thing for Oregon State. I mean, it really made a difference. Ian Shields comes in, coach, to start the third quarter for Oregon State. And almost here for Oregon State as Owens has just tripped up.
It is, and we were off sides, but they refused that penalty. And we took the win in the third quarter, hoping to pin them deep. But Oregon State was able to move the football out a little bit. You can see a good job here by Terrell Edwards playing the quarterback and getting help from the inside, Gary Williams. They were able to maintain ball possession on us in the third quarter. Shields breaking a few tackles. Jeff Cummins kind of yanked him to the ground there. We get the ball back, try the middle, pick up about 3 yards.
This is really your only possession. I mean, you have one late in the quarter, but this is it for the quarter. You only had 3.5 minutes of possession time in this third period.
Yeah, we had a lot of interesting penalties and things happen in this deal. Pick up the first down here with the blast play up the middle. Now we go back to throw. Tight end delay to Vince Ferry, who played, I might add, most of the game with a pretty bad shoulder. He got it hurt in the first quarter, kept playing, very competitive. This is a big play here. A little bit thrown behind him, could have been caught, a little better pass. That would have been a big play. They were in man. We had them beat by 2 or 3 steps. It would have not only been a first down, but a big game. We get away and break down on our option responsibility and leave the pitch man, which allows Shields to pitch the ball out and make more yardage.
Now, this is the series, they're like 3 or 4 personal fouls for the two respective teams. Oregon State moves the ball. They end up at the end of this drive getting a big personal foul that cost them.
Yes, and they were changed their blocking scheme on the option on that particular drive too. Nice play by Ernest Jones here as he comes underneath, slips the fullback, comes up and makes a tackle on Shields for a loss. But they changed their blocking scheme a little bit, and it took us a while to adjust to it. Here they go with the fumble. Ruski, Jeff Cummins stayed at home, and that was close to being gone. You can see the left guard, he's going to step down. Everybody else is chasing. Cummins comes up and realizes it, and he grabs Fletcher Keister from behind before he can break away.
So Oregon State with the ball. First down play, they get six. And here's where the penalty was called. Well, it was actually called, you couldn't see it. Dwayne Owens was ejected from the game. 15-yard personal foul that knocked him out of field position.
And Jeremy Asher's in there now. Great play by him here. Massey's out with a sprained ankle. Jeremy Asher comes in, played outstanding football the remainder of the game along with Farwell. We slipped Farwell over to the inside Mike Backer spot. And there's Farwell making another tackle.
So after all of that, Oregon State had to punt it away. Oregon gets it back. Burwell, almost.
Ooh, pick up your feet and break that tackle. A big gain up the middle. Good hole. Nice run by Burwell. Just can't get his leg out of there. Stumbled a little bit going into the tackle and was unable to make it a big, big gain.
But you're moving the ball.
Ronnie Harris, nice diving catch on the slant pattern.
And so this will be the next to the last play of the quarter.
And you can see Harris goes down and slides safely into third.
A dive into third with the football, more importantly. That ends the third quarter of play. All right, we are ready for the final quarter of the regular season. Oregon leading Oregon State 7-0, driving, looking like they might add another score. O'Neill on a 2nd and 7. Out of the pocket, just short of the first down. It's 3rd and less than 1. Shedrick bangs forward for 2 and gets the first down to the Oregon State 27. 1st and 10. Screen back, Burwell picks up 11 yards.
Another first down. It looks like we're pretty good drive. We got a nice job by David Collinsworth chopping the Oregon State rusher down. A good peel back block there by Mike DeFonso. Tattersall's out in front trying to throw a block. Burwell picks up the first down. And on first down, Whittle hits it in there. Ball stripped. We lose it, and we lose a chance to certainly get a relatively easy field goal, although in that weather, nothing's easy, or a touchdown and put the game away. Nice job of stringing the option out there and making the play. Good job, Ernest Jones. Seems like he made a lot of plays in the backfield, lots of tackles for losses. Frictions the tackle, comes off, and makes a nice play on Ian Shields.
So, 4th down, Oregon State's got to punt it away deep. Ronnie Harris finds a little crease up the middle, hurdle.
Again, great field position. Nice job on the punt return. We're running a middle return on this one. Low kick into the wind, and Ronnie does a nice job catching it. It's not easy to catch it under these conditions either. And you can see he gets a nice run right up the middle there, hurdles up in the air, and picks up valuable yardage. We try a fake field goal here. We don't run it very well, and then we do something that isn't very good in throwing that ball up for grabs, and Oregon State stops it.
Oregon State comes back, gets the first down pass here. I mean, at this stage, I mean, it's kind of like last week against UCLA in some respects in that, I mean, one score and they're right back in a football game.
That's right. Nice job here by Jeff Cummins coming off, making the play on Shields in the backfield, another tackle for loss.
So it's 2nd down and 14. We'll try the middle. Nothing there. It's all plugged up.
Jeremy Asher, excellent job. Great job by Tommy, fielding a bad snap, and gets off a great punt into the wind, and nice coverage down there by Mike Allison and Asher.
At this point, the wind had died down substantially, I think. Was it still raining as hard?
It was raining harder at this point than it was all day long. Nice job by Paul Rodriguez, Paul played a great game. He started the game at corner because of the injury to Herman O'Berry. You can see Rodriguez coming up and finishing this tackle off. He then had to switch back to strong safety when Cota went out with a mild concussion, and Eugene Jackson came in right there making a play at corner. So we had some injury problems on our defensive side, but we were able to have people step up and play well. And Paul Rodriguez was one, getting a start in his last regular season game, did a great job. A lot of people were wondering if I was maybe going to take a safety in that situation. I elected not to because I didn't want to give them an opportunity to have 2 points. Here comes the next fumble, Ruski. Asher knocks the ball loose. Farwell knocked it loose and Asher recovered it.
You were talking about the safety. If you give them 2 points, all they have to do is score the touchdown.
And we lose. So I figured we'd make them earn everything that they were going to get. And it turned out that it was a good decision. And you can see here, we're just needing some yards to pick up some first downs to keep the clock running, which we're able to do. And there we are, killing the clock to end the game.
So the 96th Civil War is over. Terrell Edwards hoping to do a little bowling. And a little celebration, a very emotional game. Let's take a look at the statistics. And not an offensive game by any stretch of the imagination. First downs, 12-9. Rushing yardage, Oregon State had come in leading the Pac-10, one of the national leaders in rushing, held to 88. Passing, you can see how tough it was to throw the football for both teams. Total offense, Oregon 239, Oregon State 110. Turnovers, each with a pair. Penalties, you can see both teams flagged more than their seasonal averages. Punting, kudos to both guys for punting on that day. They really did a good job in third down conversions, 38% for both teams. Individual statistics, Ricky Whittle, the leading ball carrier, 11 for 66 yards. He got 47 on one attempt. Burwell, so the tailbacks again combined for over 100 yards for the Ducks. Passing department, Danny O'Neill, 8 of 15, 80 yards, and that one touchdown. Ian Shields, 1 for 3 for 11. And defensively, a lot of guys had 6, 7, 8 tackles, but here were the leaders, Farwell, Cummins, 2 seniors, and Ernest Jones, 3 tackles for losses. After the game, we talked to the players in the locker room.
Coach Shuler said they had 92 total yards at the end of the third quarter, so you know they couldn't end up too much over 100, and that feels real good from the defensive standpoint. You know, the offense got one touchdown in, and that did it for us. You know, it was a tough game, and you know it's a great feeling to go out like that as a senior, and you know I'm glad our team pulled it out.
You know, and I got freed up on a few plays and had some chances to make some fairly good hits, so it was, you know, it's just it couldn't end any better as far as I'm concerned.
I'm sure it threw the game plan out the window in a sense. To me, it was miserable. You know, my hands were pretty much frozen by the third, fourth quarter. So, but you know, our offense responded well, and we got some first downs and when we needed them, and put 7 points on the board, and that's all that counts.
Obi Babs and I run up the field, and we cross. We're parallel in a wing set, and I think both guys came with me, and Obi was wide open at first, but I don't know if Danny could see because he was rolling out the other way. He just tossed up a beautiful ball, you know, only where I could get it, and I just went up, made the grab, and made sure my foot was in bounds so it would count for 6. We're all relieved that we scored a touchdown because we haven't scored one in a couple years, and we're very happy with the win.
Today was a great day for the linemen. I mean, we got to get after it. We knew we were going to run the ball a lot, and that's something I like to do. I mean, I love playing in the rain. You know, that's one of the reasons I came up here because I love the weather, and I just had a great time.
We lost a lot of close games that we had chances to win, you know, but I think we got better as time went on, and I think we do deserve a shot. If we do get that shot, I think we'll take full advantage of it.
I think it was more for our self-pride. We're 5-5, and we don't believe that we're a 500 team. We're a 6-5 team, you know, and we're definitely above a 500 team, and I think that was the main reason going into it. Yeah, we want to beat OSU, and yeah, it's a big rivalry, but hey, they're a one-win a year team, and that's not us. That's not what we're out here for. We're going to win 6, 7, 8, 9 games a year, and the big thing for us is go out and attain that.
What I was thinking about was just beating Oregon State, you know, coming back and owning the state. You know, they put out that video, and there were some motivational factors that they did that got us kind of fired up, I think. And then all the bowl and all that other stuff, you know, that was important too.
Well, you talk about intensity, pregame warm-ups, Chad Cota bumping helmets with Joe Farwell. Cota comes out with a chipped tooth right in half, and still played with it, said it didn't hurt him, but that's what kind of a game This is when these two teams get together. We want to thank everybody who has helped put this program together, from the coaching staff to the folks behind the cameras and to the studio audience that's been with us. Thank you very much for watching. We hope you enjoyed it. And as we go to the break, let's give you a little of the highlight action you've seen this year, along with the folks that helped put this show together.
Stay with OBB for the Nightly Business Report next.
Oregon Sports Network presents The Rich Brooks Show, sponsored in part by Budweiser.